at it, so it doesn't take long to read this bill. It's pretty simple. The bill basically says no federal funds may be used to install permanent fencing around the Capitol or around the Capitol buildings. Not very complicated, but the statement we make by passing this legislation and then following it will make a big difference. We're filing this bill today. I'm glad to be joined by Senator Van Hollen. We've worked together on a number of things, but pleased to be working together on this. And I think I'll let him come up, and then we'll let Elder Holmes Norton bat cleanup on this issue and whatever else she wants to talk about.
Thank you, Roy. Well, thank you, Roy, and it's great to join with Senator Blunt and Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton in introducing this bill. This Capitol is the citadel of democracy, and we should not turn it into a fortress. We should not wall the People's House off from the people of the United States of America. We can achieve security here without building a wall, and we know that from various people who have weighed in. And I think it would be a huge mistake and send the wrong signal, both in our country and around the world, if this place of democracy was not accessible by the people who elected the representatives and senators who gather here to do the people's business. So to Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton, thank you for taking the first step in the House, and Senator Blunt and I are pleased to join you in this bipartisan way. This Capitol has survived many attacks over the centuries, including the War of 1812 and in 1814, the efforts to burn down the Capitol. We didn't have a wall after that. We don't need a wall now, and I'm pleased to be introducing this legislation. Let me now introduce Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton.
Well, we don't see nearly as much bipartisan and bicameral action, the kind we're seeing here today and that we will see as we introduce this bill called the No Fencing at the United States Capitol Complex Act. If you've come in this way, you've already seen the fence become tumbling down, gradually tumbling down, until it is gone altogether, and the people of the United States take control of their own capital once again. We need to put that terrible day behind us. You can't do it as long as this fencing is up to remind people that they can't get into the Capitol. When I came over to the Rayburn Building, I could already see some of the streets opening up. Recently, when I tried to get to the Capitol, I couldn't even get there. So much of the Capitol complex was closed off that every place was a detour. And that was the framing, actually, for what has happened to the Capitol. So finally, we had a task force that Speaker Pelosi set up, and they came forward with the notion of an invisible fence in the bottom and a lot of other security safeguards that we need. For example, we're getting 350 new Capitol Police who were doing double time because they were so underfunded. Now that we have bipartisan and bicameral support, it's time to get rid of fences of the kind that were invented 10,000 years ago. I so appreciate my good friends for being here today with us in the Capitol.
Great. What questions you all have?
How widespread is the bipartisan support within the House and the Senate for this proposal? And maybe if you could talk a little bit anecdotally about, a lot of lawmakers have complained about the fencing around the Capitol.
Well, you know, we are just now introducing this on the Senate side, but I have a feeling that the support is broad. I mentioned it to a couple of people on the way out of the building today that both said, put me on the bill. So far, 100% of everybody I've mentioned it to has wanted to join, but we're just getting started. I think Chris and I'll be working. We'll be frankly looking for either a bill that comes over or a bill that we can put this on in the foreseeable future. And I believe we can do this successfully. You know, as both Senator Van Hollen and Congresswoman Holmes Norton said, this building has been here for a long time. It has a level of access that is in so many ways unique in the world. We don't want to lose that. Also, as the chairman and now the top Republican on the Rules Committee that thinks about these issues a lot, the idea that the next challenge we face will be exactly like the last challenge we face is very close to zero. Spending all our time and effort on something like a wall or a fort would be a bad idea. All of us who've spent any time around Washington knows that there's always a reason that somebody has to make it harder to get somewhere. Pennsylvania Avenue was closed temporarily 25 years ago. There are many other examples just like that. And I think the three of us don't want this to become one of those things. It's just easier today to close it than not. And before you know it, it never opens back up. Elder Chris?
Well, the Speaker Pelosi has already advanced this bill by setting up this task force. It was that task force that reported back. So I don't see any opposition on our side, and I certainly hearing my good friends on the Senate side see one. So let's all celebrate that. We may have 100% support on both sides for this bill.
Yeah, I share my colleagues' optimism about this. I don't know of anybody yet who's opposed, and I know many people who are for. Right. So that's a good place to be.
Yeah. Senator Van Hollen, so Acting Chief Yogananda Pittman called for a permanent fence on January 28th. That's clearly something that the three of you are, you know, united in opposition to. Additionally, a lot of her officers have said that they don't have confidence in the current leadership structure of the Capitol Police. You know, a name that's been floated for chief of police has been Tom Lloyd, as an inspector. Just a question for all three of you. Do you have confidence in the current leadership of the Capitol Police, and do you think there is a need for change?
Well, there's already been change in the sergeant-at-arms. And I believe there's a new Capitol Police chief that's been appointed. Given what happened on January 6th, I think there's been across the board changes here of the kind we needed.
Well, and Acting Chief Pittman's had an incredible challenge. I don't know that she has any interest in being the permanent chief. I have thought for some time that the police board itself doesn't function very well in easy circumstances and really is designed not to function at all in a crisis, and that was proven on January the 6th. We're talking to lots of people in the Rules Committee. The Rules Committee and the Homeland Security Committee have done, as you know, two joint hearings. We're doing lots of interviews. We brought an extra staff who knows what they're doing to these interviews. I think the Congress itself has the potential here to solve the problems that we're aware of. It's just a matter of whether we can get that done or not. I don't know that we need a commission to do that. I'm not opposed to a commission, but a commission would in all likelihood slow down our understanding of what needs to be done. I think Eleanor's view that we need to have better training and more people in the force at some level would be shared by the force itself. And from the point of view of the acting chief, it's hard to imagine a more challenging time to take over when the sergeant-at-arms of both the House and Senate and your predecessor have all resigned. And so we're working closely with them to try to get us to the next step in this process.
Yeah, I would just say leave the question as to the ultimate leadership of the Capitol Police to a further discussion. But I would point out that Lieutenant General Desiree, who Speaker Pelosi brought in to review, security in the immediate aftermath of the attacks, said that a fence would not provide the security that we need. That was his assessment. It's one we share.
Okay. Kind of follow up on that point, though. How do you ensure the safety of the Capitol and the members staff journalists without offense and with the lack of confidence in police leadership?
Well, look, I think that the way forward in terms, as Senator, as Roy was saying, if you look at January 6th, we had a failure of intelligence. And it's pretty clear that there are alternatives to fencing, and I think better alternatives, including increasing the number and capacity of the Capitol Police, including having clear protocols for when you can bring in National Guard members. And this bill doesn't preclude any kind of short-term, you know, fencing that may be needed if you believe a big crowd is coming and you can't control that crowd. But we just don't think a permanent fence is necessary. In fact, we think it would provide a false sense of security and would wall off the Congress from the American people, which is a very bad signal.
I just want to say that in addition to the invisible fencing, I'm having a meeting with the architect of the Capitol and some that he has said should be invited in for a town meeting in my own district to discuss ways other than the fencing that is underground. What we have not been using is all of the state-of-the-art technology that has been available to us, and I hope that this meeting will make it clear how the Capitol can use that state-of-the-art technology when everybody else out there is using it.
Okay, go ahead.
So, has the Capitol Police Board given you the impression that they want a permanent fence? I mean, what's the impetus for this, especially as, you know, you guys have made it clear you don't want to fund this, and we see spent some of the fence?
Well, the impetus is that you leave this permanent fence up for very long, and before you know it, it turns into some kind of this temporary fence for very long, it turns into some kind of permanent fence. We've seen this happen over and over again in Washington, D.C., and state capitals. We don't want that to happen. And in terms of the police board, you know, the police board is just now getting permanent members 2 months after the old board effectively resigned. I'm hoping that the architect of the Capitol, if he continues to be a member of the police board in the future, takes his Naval Academy experience, his naval experience, and his construction experience at both of the airports and becomes a bigger voice on that board. But frankly, I've thought for a long time, like I said, the board does not function well. I asked for a study on this in 2016. At that time, the leadership in the House and Senate, who appoint two-thirds of the board, didn't want to make changes, and we'll be looking for what changes we can suggest and see how they react to that. Yes?
When do you expect your committee to call Secretary Miller, former Secretary Miller, to testify?
I'd like to call him. We don't have jurisdiction in the Rules Committee to over defense, and that would really be up to the Homeland Security partners. I've made it clear to them and publicly as well that I think both he and the Secretary of the Army, the Acting Secretary of Defense and the Secretary of the Army, should want to testify to clarify how the things that happened on January 6th could have possibly happened. There's one 30-minute gap between the time they say the decision was made and they tell anybody. That's absolutely unacceptable. Surely that's not what really happened, but if you read the Defense Department timeline, that's what the timeline says happened. One more?
When you talk to former security officials for the Capitol, like Sergeant at Arms, police chiefs, they say that fencing could have stopped January 6th. It buys law enforcement time to fight off any kind of attack as we saw that day. And it's something they've been asking for the last 40 years. And they say lawmakers are just not willing to pay that price, the same way, let's say, TSA paid the price after 9/11 with those kind of security implementations. What would you say to those kind of arguments that Congress is not willing to put up the kind of security that they think is needed at the Capitol?
Well, it's you know, I have great respect for the Capitol Police. I work with them a lot. I talk to them a lot. I think the training they have can be better than it was for that event. As Senator Van Hollen said, when you have good intelligence, you need to be sure you're acting on it. And the same fence that was going to come up a week later for the inauguration, certainly could have come up a week earlier if that intelligence had been viewed in the same way. I mean, that's one of the possibilities. You know, none of us are saying we don't want a fence anywhere, anytime. And when you anticipate you need it, you can put it up. But it will make a big difference in how this building looks to people that come from all over America and all over the world if it is incredibly hard to get in and it looks like you've turned the capital of the United States into a fort, not the citadel of democracy. We done? Anybody else? Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We got everybody.